Hi, this video is going to examine two sample hypothesis testing, looking for the difference between means for dependent samples this time. And recall that independent samples are drawn independently of one another. They don't influence each other, the units within them. Whereas for dependent samples, there is a paired sample going on, or matched sample. If each member of one sample corresponds to a member of the other. So if we want to, for example, compare the weight of 24 students in a first grade class to the height of the same students, well, because they're the same students, those samples are dependent. They are paired together with respect to each student. But down here, where we're looking at the average price of 15 new trucks versus 20 used sedans, those are independent. Those are not depending on each other. So to perform a two-sample hypothesis test with dependent samples, we need to first find the difference between each data pair. That is going to be represented by D, which is X1 minus X2. And then we'll find our test statistic, which is the mean difference, or D, of those independent or dependent differences, rather. So the mean is simply the sum of the differences over the sample size, represented by this equation. And if those conditions are met, we can conduct our test. And though the samples are dependent, we still assume that they are randomly selected and that their populations are normally distributed. Based on that, the t-distribution is appropriate with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. So a quick review of our notation here. N is going to be the number of pairs of data. D is the difference between entries for data pairs, so maybe that's student weight and student height. The hypothesized mean of the differences is the mu, the population mean difference. The D bars are sample difference average, and SD is the standard deviation of differences between the paired data entries in dependent samples. And that is found with this equation down here. Then you can see the adjustment for degrees of freedom in the denominator here. And it's simply the sample size times the sum of the difference squared minus the sum of the difference squared. And that's going to give us our SD. So based on satisfying those assumptions, we look at our test statistic, D bar, as the sum of D over N. We can use that to find our standardized test statistic, T, which is D bar minus the population difference, mu D, and that's divided by the variance of the difference for our sample, divided by the square root of our sample size with degrees of freedom of N minus 1. So the steps in this test are as follows. As usual, we state our claim mathematically with our HO and HA. We identify our alpha level and our degrees of freedom, N minus 1. Determine our critical values using the t-distribution this time with N minus 1 degrees of freedom. We then use that to determine the rejection regions. We calculate the d-bar and SD values using these equations and our table. And then from that we find the standardized test statistic using this equation that we reviewed previously. Next, we make our decision to either reject or fail to reject the null, and then interpret that decision in the context of the original claim. So here's an example. We have a reading center that claims students will perform better on a standardized reading test after going through the reading course offered by their center. So this table shows the reading scores of six students, and note that they're dependent because it's the same six students that we're comparing, so they're paired. And it's a before and after score based on going through a reading center. At the alpha 0.05 level, we're testing whether or not there's enough evidence to conclude the students' scores after the course were significantly better than they were before the course. So stated mathematically, our null is that the difference is less than or equal to zero. An alternative is that it's greater than zero, the difference. So this shows for degrees of freedom 6 minus 1, which is 5, at alpha 0.05 level, If we look that up on our t-distribution, we get 2.015 for our cutoff. Down here, we have our student test scores before and after, our differences for each student, and then the squared differences down here. That gives us those values, which we then plug in down here. So D bar, we find, is going to be the sum of differences over the sample size, which gives us negative 7.167. And our variance down here is calculated to be 10.245. Continuing the example, we then calculate our test statistic, and plugging in the values from before, we come to negative 1.714, and that is definitely not in the rejection area. There's not enough evidence at the 5% level to support the claim that the student's scores improved as a result of going through the program.